Ready to go?
Great.
Well, this is the day that the Lord hath made, and we will rejoice and be glad in it. I'm Pastor Rob Miolis, and it is the first week of February, and it is rather snowy outside, but we rejoice that we have these capabilities now that whether you're in here or at home or in the parking lot, that we can worship together. And so whether you're calling in or watching with us live, we trust that the Holy Spirit is working to bring us together, that we might hear God's word, glorify and praise God, and be equipped to live as disciples this upcoming week. And so I invite us now to take a breath and to know that God's presence is with us as we worship. Thank you for that, Audrey. At this point, I invite us to rise. And we worship in the name in which we baptize, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. God of all mercy and consolation, come to the help of your people turning us away from our sin to live for you alone. Give us the power of your Holy Spirit that we may confess our sin, receive your forgiveness, and grow in the fullness of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Let us pause for reflection as we confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Most merciful God, we confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your holy name. Amen. Hear the good news. For by grace you have been saved. Jesus Christ, out of great love by God, was sent to die for your sins. And as he lives victorious from the grave, I declare to you that in his name your sins are forgiven. Amen and alleluia. Together we're going to sing 314, Arise, Your Light Has Come. And for those that are gathered here, I think there are a few of us that I am comfortable with us singing this morning.
Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
Praise you for your glory, Lord Jesus Christ, our
us join our hearts in prayer. Everlasting God, you give strength to the weak and power to the faint. Make us agents of your healing and wholeness, that your good news may be made known to the ends of your creation, through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. And you may be seated for the readings from God's Word.
At the time the prophet Isaiah was prophesying, the people of ancient Israel had been in exile for nearly 5 decades. Although Isaiah was prophesying the end of the exile, the people had begun to doubt God's power and care. In the passage we will hear today, the prophet speaks for God, reminding them that God is powerful and that God cares for them. God also offers a sweet word of promise to a people and to us who are struggling with hope amid the darkness, renewal that comes through patient faith. The reading from Isaiah. Have you not known? Have you not heard? Has it not been told to you from the beginning? Have you not understood from the foundations of the earth? It is the Lord who sits above the circle of the earth, and its inhabitants are like grasshoppers, who stretches out the heavens like a curtain and spreads them like a tent to live in, who brings princes to naught and makes the rulers of the earth as nothing. Scarcely are they planted, scarcely sown, scarcely has their stem taken root in the earth, when God blows upon them and they wither, and the tempest carries them off like the stubble. To whom then will you compare me? Or who is my equal, says the Holy One? Lift up your eyes on high and see. Who created these? The one who brings out their host and numbers them, calling them all by name, because the Lord is great in strength, mighty in power. Not one is missing. Why do you say, O Jacob, and speak, O Israel, my way is hidden from the Lord, and my right is disregarded by my God? Have you not known? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. The Lord does not faint or grow weary. His understanding is unsearchable. God gives power to the faint and strengthens the powerless. Even youths will faint and be weary, and the young will fall exhausted. But those who wait for the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. We will read responsively Psalm 147. Hallelujah! How good it is to sing praises to our God. How pleasant it is to honor God with praise.
The Lord rebuilds Jerusalem and gathers the exiles of Israel.
The Lord heals the brokenhearted and binds up their wounds.
The Lord counts the number of the stars and calls them all by their names.
Great is our Lord and mighty in power. There is no limit to God's wisdom.
The Lord lifts up the lowly, but casts the wicked to the ground.
Sing to the Lord with thanksgiving. Make music upon the harp to our God, who covers the heavens with clouds and prepares rain for the earth, making grass to grow up on the mountains. God provides food for the cattle and for the young ravens when they cry. God is not impressed by the might of a horse and has no pleasure in the speed of a runner. but finds pleasure in those who fear the Lord, in those who await God's steadfast love. Hallelujah.
Please rise as you are able. Gospel according to St. Mark. Glory to you, O Lord. As soon as Jesus and the disciples left the synagogue, they entered the house of Simon and Andrew with James and John. Now Simon, later to be called Peter, his mother-in-law was in bed with a fever, and they told him about her at once. Jesus came and seized her by the hand and lifted her up. Then the fever left her, and she began to serve them. That evening at sundown, they brought to him all who were sick or possessed with demons. The whole city was gathered around their door. He cured many who were sick with various diseases and cast out many demons, and he would not permit the demons to speak because they knew him. In the morning, while it was still dark, he arose and went out to a deserted place, and there he prayed. And Simon and his companions hunted for him. When they found him, they said, "Everyone is searching for you." He answered, "Let us go to the neighboring towns, so that I may proclaim the message there also, for this is what I have come to do." And he went out through Galilee, proclaiming the message in their synagogues and casting out demons. The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. I invite you to be seated and for our children's message.
Better? Can you hear? Oh, yes, that worked. Boys and girls of all ages, this children's sermon time is for you, and I would like you to both see and hear what I have to share with you today. I have a toy. I'm sorry. This is just going to need another chance here. Let's try this again. I have a toy that I'm eager to show you, and the toy was made downstairs at St. Paul's Church in our toy workshop. So this toy was made by Joe Doster downstairs with all the senior shepherd's toys that he makes. I want to show you how it works. When I spin this, it will ravel and ravel and ravel up. And then the fun, of course, is in letting it go and watching it spin back and unravel. And go back and forth and back and forth till it comes to a stop. Well, Mr. Doster has made these toys. He's made different kinds. He could have put anything on this toy. In fact, he's made these toys with cars on each post. He's made these toys with airplanes on each post. But he made this toy for us here at church with four very interesting and special symbols. You can see here a man, a lion, an eagle, and an ox. We have here Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. All four Gospels on this toy. Today, I want to show you Mark, the lion. Mark is represented by a lion, and Mark is the story, the book, that we're hearing the most from this year. We're in the stories of Mark. Mark's stories of Jesus are wild and fierce, strong and powerful. We are only 30 verses into Mark, and Jesus has been baptized, tempted, he's been in the wilderness, he's been casting out demons, he's healing crowds. It is a wild and powerful Jesus that is at work in the gospel that we've been following these weeks of Epiphany. And so I wanted you to get to see this toy, but especially to see and look at the lion, to know the journey that we are currently on this Epiphany. It's a bit of a wild one, but it is a wild and powerful, strong Jesus that we follow in these words. So I will spin this again, but I invite you to pray with me while I do. Please repeat after me. Thank you, Lord, for your wild word. Help us follow it. Amen.
My batteries are low. Okay, if my batteries go out, just wave hands and I'll switch it again. This is all part of the journey. It's all good. Visiting people in prison is one of the strange tasks of a pastor. And whenever I have done it, it is a very draining experience, very humiliating and very moving each time. And after one such visit, I saw a warden on the way out, and I knew this warden. He was a relative of another church member, and I said, what can we do as a church for people who are incarcerated? And at first, his answer seemed disappointing. He said, really not much. And he said, look, when they're in the prison, they have food, they have shelter, they have access to education, and there are some good ministries that happen in the prison you could support. But where they really need help is when they leave prison. Again, where they really need help is when they leave prison. And it was sort of this light bulb went off and this realization that even though somebody could be free of their sentence, free of prison, this didn't necessarily mean that they had been healed. And the same dysfunction that plagued their life inside and externally before, what we called unclean spirits in the Gospel of Mark, were still there with them in their life to be wrestled with. And it brought about this realization that healing is often accompanied at least in two steps. There's some sort of moment of release, of a cure, of a breakup, of something that happens, an event that sort of frees us, a surgery. And then there's a time of healing, a journey towards wholeness that is often longer and more complicated. In the story that we heard from Mark's gospel, Peter's mother-in-law, or Simon's mother-in-law, he eventually became Peter, was healed. And again, for those that grew up Roman Catholic, that is right. Peter was married and had a mother-in-law, okay? But regardless, Peter's mother-in-law is healed. And what happens is that Jesus seizes her by the hand, he raises her up, and then the fever leaves her. But this is not all that happens. That cure is only part of the healing. What happens next is really the completion of the healing. And that is where she is now able to get up and she's able to serve Jesus, serve the disciples. And then as it turns out, all the neighborhood comes. Everybody starts coming to the house. It's like there's a vaccine clinic going on, right? And people are carrying people to Jesus and they've signed up at 5 a.m. online for their 10-minute slots with Jesus. They're all clamoring to get a piece. And so suddenly, Peter's mother-in-law must attend and provide hospitality, even for those on the margins, those who are sick, those who are weakened. So this is something where she has been restored to a position of generosity, of hospitality, of purpose in her life for Jesus, for her fellow believers, and then most ultimately for all those on need in the community. Again, this story shows that healing isn't just simply about a quick cure or a surgery or an exorcism or any sort of one-time thing, but it's often then accompanied and followed by another phase, a process of restoration where we're made whole on many levels. Recently, every conversation that I have has been dominated by the vaccine, right? I can't talk to anybody without ultimately it coming up, who's getting it, where they got it, and there's a mixture of joy and jealousy when we find out that somebody else has gotten it. And it's interesting, too, because Martin Luther says that our God is whatever we fear, love, and trust above all things. And I would dare say that at this point we are starting to elevate a vaccine to a lofty level, maybe even an idol. Now, it is true. The vaccine is a gift from God. And, just on the number of people that are listening to this service alone, likely at least one person who's listening or participating in the service, their life will be saved by the vaccine. So I know I wish to minimize the gift that it is from God. But the truth is that two shots in the arm is not going to heal all that has transpired in the last year. Again, two shots in the arm is not going to fix or bring wholeness and righteousness in all of our relationships, in our world, in our society, and in our lives. It may release us from the fever, as Jesus released Peter's mother-in-law from the fever, but again, it won't necessarily bring the healing and wholeness that we so desperately crave. That really is a longer work of God in our lives. Now, I think about in most of our families, there are people, our children, grandchildren, parents, grandparents, who we really haven't been able to see very much in the last year. It's been quite difficult. It's been a strain on relationships. I also think there are many people we love who we live with, and at some point we chose to live with them. But wow, 24/7 with people over the course of a year is a lot of time with people, as it turns out. Right? There may be some comments, some conversations, some patterns that have been tougher within relationships in this last year. Friends who we used to be close with, but this year's political divides or other conversations, suddenly we're not sure how close we are, even if we want reconciliation with them. Again, this is just one aspect of our lives in terms of our relationships. There are so many others: economic, political, racial, social, environmental. I mean, the list goes on of all the ways in which in our lives we recognize that it's not just about two shots, but it's a sense of wholeness that we're looking for. This week in Bible study, a woman boldly shared vulnerably and said, I had COVID in December, and this person had it very badly. In fact, they went to the hospital. It was really a hard time for them. And they said, but now they're over it, and they find that they're not satisfied. She said, my life now is I watch TV, I go on Facebook, and then I order stuff online. This is not the fullness of God's kingdom. This person has been cured. The fever has left them, but the sense of wholeness of the life that God has called us, where we serve Jesus, others, and even those on the margin, where we find meaning and beauty and purpose in our days, this has not yet come to her. This Lent, we're going to journey together, as always during Lent, and we're going to do so this year under the theme of Create in me a clean heart, O God. Those powerful verses from Psalm 51. We're subtitling it A Journey Towards Wholeness, because again, in so many aspects of our lives, we leave the last year aware of a lot of brokenness, areas where we're longing for, hoping for wholeness to be recreated and renewed in Jesus Christ. Now, in the story we heard from the Gospel of Mark, the healing, the second part in terms of restoration, it's pretty quick, and it looks a lot like it did for life before, right? Peter's mother-in-law, I'm sure she had been hospitable before. This was just maybe in a new way and maybe an even more important way, right, for Jesus right there. But it kind of looked the same, and it kind of was pretty quick. I'd like to offer that as we journey together this Lent to be mindful that healing, a restoration, a reconciliation, a sense of God's righteousness and right relationships in our life doesn't always quite happen so quickly. And it doesn't quite always happen as an on-off switch right back to the way things were. The Isaiah passage we heard is from the time when the exile was ending. And the exile was a time about 50 years where the Jewish leaders were taken into captivity after Jerusalem fell into the hands of the Babylonians. And finally, about 50 years later, the Persians conquered the Babylonians, so that's Iran conquers Iraq. And so the Jews that were then in Babylon were now free to go back to Jerusalem. But it turns out that many of them didn't want to go back. It had been 50 years. Many of them only had childhood memories of Jerusalem. Many of them, in fact, had never been there. And they had children. They had spouses. They had jobs. They didn't want to leave and go 1,000 miles across the Middle Eastern desert to resettle and to rebuild their lives again. So it became a complex time for Judaism. And out of this time in exile and the period following, the Jews begin to realize something, that they need to write down their scriptures. They weren't all living together as tribes anymore. They needed to write down their scriptures. And so we have actually the written word of God coming to us out of that time. And moreover, they began to realize that their children were no longer speaking Hebrew. They were speaking whatever language the people spoke, likely Aramaic or a host of other languages. And so there needed to now be teachers who could read the Word of God in its original language and explain it to people and what it meant. In other words, rabbis. Before that, there were just priests. Now there would be rabbis, which our Lord and our Savior is identified as a rabbi, coming out of this tradition of people who could teach the word. And this became the ministry of the early church that continues this day in the preaching and teaching. In other words, during this time, there was a healing, a transformation that God was bringing about, in which God was bringing forth the word in a new way to the people that ultimately then could be for all of the people to the ends of the earth. The healing and transformation that we should expect in this coming year is not always going to be like an on-off switch, but it may be a longer process of God working on our lives to bring about righteousness and right relationship and renewal. So, for instance, today is a snow day, and there's not a lot of people in the sanctuary. Last year, had we had snow on a Sunday morning the first week of February, I would have been in a panic. Do we cancel church? What do we do? Because as it turns out, there would have been no way other than 10 of you calling in on a phone number. That would have been it. That's all we could have done for worship. But you see, over the last year, this whole thing has gone on long enough that we said, wow, we've got to figure out some new ways to broadcast. And so I think something around 80 to 100 people watched our first service, even though there were not that many people in the early service today. Worship was able to go on in a new way. Again, God was working something during this time, bringing us in a time of healing to something new. Now, I did mention how many people had worshiped. And I am a pastor. I've spent a lot of time, too much time in my ministry, worried about numbers. And COVID has done something where I can no longer count how many people are in church. It turns out that I really can't get that data out of YouTube. And really, I can tell number of views, but does a 3-second view really count as going to church? No, it doesn't. It doesn't. So how do we do this? And I have no way of counting how many people have called in on our landline today. So I can't count anymore how many of you came to worship today. God is breaking me of my need, dare say, an addiction to numbers in this way. I have to simply trust that what we're doing is the word is going forth. So what I'm trying to get at here is that when God works healing in our lives, it's not always a linear process. It's not always an on-off switch, but it's God bringing about a sense of wholeness, shalom, righteousness in our lives. And so there are times where we'll find ourselves saying, Lord, how long? Right? How long? And there's a political thing there where you can call up your representative and say, we need to get this moving. But before God, our impatience is something different. And when we go to God and we say, God, how long until my life gets back to the way that it should be? How long until there's a sense of normalcy, or most deeply, how long until I feel whole again? We get two answers back there, I think. The first is certainly not a calendar or a date or a time. No. No, what we get back is the answer, as long as it takes. As long as it takes for God to work the transformation that God wants to in our lives. Again, how long will it be till we are restored? As long as it takes for God to work on our hearts and to mold us into the disciples that we are called to be. And the other answer, of course, is those words from Isaiah that those who wait upon the Lord shall have their strength renewed as if on wings of an eagle. And that we will discover that indeed God is carrying us, strengthening us during this time. In Mark's gospel, we see clearly, we learn clearly that Jesus is this fierce lion who's combating the forces of evil and sickness and illness in this world. Jesus is on a mission to save and to heal the world, to rebuild it and make it new in God's image. And nothing will stop Jesus from accomplishing this. And we know, though, that Mark, and then really our whole Lenten journey then, is one of walking with Jesus ultimately to the cross, where the cross becomes the center, the fountain of healing, in which Christ takes on our brokenness, our sin, our shame, our pain, our impatience. And he takes it all on, and he lets it die with him on the cross, that as he's reborn, he might give to us his life, his resurrection, and his power. Amen.
And he will raise you up on eagle's wings, hear you on the breath of dawn, make you to shine like the sun, and hold you in the palm of his hand. To the Lord, my refuge,
please rise. Let us now confess our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is, seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshiped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Guided by Christ on mission to heal and set free, let us pray now for the church, the world, and all who are in need. Benevolent God, assist helping ministries, both in the church and in the community, to provide pathways toward health and wholeness with compassion and skill. We pray those in need of help be able to locate the programs and services available to them, and that organizations have the resources to meet the needs they encounter, that those who serve and those who are served experience freedom and release in your holy name. Lord, in your mercy. Sovereign God, for the nations, for all who lead in cities and towns, states and countries, for community organizers, school officials, CEOs, for international health organizations, that in times of trial, fear, hopelessness, they discover fresh courage and resolve in the message Christ proclaims of your kingdom to come. Lord, in your mercy. Merciful God, like Simon's mother-in-law, when healed by Christ's hand, began to serve others. We pray for all who are wearied by life's burdens, for those who are poor or in debt, for those lacking supportive relationships, for those struggling in this pandemic, for those exhausted from overwork or stress, and for all who cry out to you, that you relieve their burdens and grant the joy of sharing gifts. Lord, in your mercy. Loving God, hear these prayers of your people, those spoken and now those we uplift to you, also silently in our hearts. We lift them for the sake of the one who dwells among us, your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen.
In my sermon, I spoke about our Lenten theme of Create in Me a Clean Heart, O God, a journey towards wholeness. And we will begin Lent two Wednesdays from now on the 17th, and we will have three worship services, one at 11, one at 7 in the morning, one at 11 in the morning, and one at 7 at night. And we will have three ways to do imposition of ashes. One, we'll have the traditional. I'll put an ashen cross on your forehead. We also have temporary tattoos. So you can dip it in the baptismal font, and you can stick it on yourself, and there's no touching. And if you come in your car outside, I can also give you ashes after worship that way. On Sunday the 14th, that's next Sunday, it's also Valentine's Day, and Deacon Emily and I will be leading a renewal of vows. Today's your last day to sign up for that. We have some sort of some basic instructions for that and some activities for those. So again, we have room for that. And actually, in regards to the Ash Wednesday service, one more thing. We do not need sign-ups for that. Again, we anticipate a small enough number that you do not need to sign up for that. There are a number of ways in which we can dig into the Word during Lent. We will again be offering devotions via video. We also have a devotion book right over here. And the snow may not have messed up our ability to worship together, but it may have slowed down our ability to get these books out to people. So if you would like a book, they're at the church, and if you're not going to be able to come today or next Sunday, let us know, and there'll be a way you can stop by the church and pick one up. It's really one book, one church, one heart this year, and this will be the devotions for all ages this year. There's also some other faith opportunities in addition to the normal weekly classes we have. There's also a new grief group that will be starting soon, as well as a one-day sort of mini retreat at Whittle Farm. Lastly, I just thank everyone for your faithful contributions to the church that allow us to continue in mission and in ministry. And though at this point, I would invite us all to rise.
Let us pray. O God, receive these gifts as you receive us, like a mother receives her child with arms open wide. Nourish us anew in your tender care and empower us in faithful service to tend to others in this same love, through Jesus Christ, our saving grace. Amen.
And bear the name of Christ. Send us with your promises and lead your people forth in joy with shouts of thanksgiving. Alleluia, alleluia.
We are all eager, certainly, for a vaccine and our friends and our family to get them and it to be rolled out in society. But we know deeply that ultimately two shots in the arm is not going to complete the journey of healing and wholeness that we are hungry for and that we need. And so in these coming weeks of Lent, I invite you to join us as we walk together with Jesus ultimately to his cross, that we might reflect on, discover, and ultimately be healed and be brought fullness through his great love. So as you go forth this week, may the joy and peace that passes all understanding guard your hearts and minds in Jesus Christ. Amen. And together we sing a wonderful hymn, 858, Praise to the Lord, the Almighty.
Praise to the Lord, the Almighty.
with you always. Please take a moment to share God's peace with one another in your homes, in your cars, and here in the sanctuary through the sign language for peace. Become calm. Now go in peace, be the light of Christ. Thanks be to God.
Lord God, our power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna.
The night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, broke it, gave thanks, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, and after he had given thanks, he gave it to all, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this in remembrance of me." For as often as we do this, we proclaim the great mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. And in that great hope, we pray as our Savior taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever.